Hello guys, my name is Diego Pacheco and this will be another video. So today we will do a slide cast about architecture. So let's get started. So I have a short slide deck I want to go through with you all, right, about architecture. So let's go there. So my name is Diego Pacheco. I am software architect. I wrote the book Building Applications with Scala. I create the series of videos building effective microservices with Java and Netflix OS stack. Here is my GitHub, my Twitter, my Blogger, and also my YouTube channel, right? So today, talking about software architecture, the first thing I want to talk is the definition of software architecture. I don't think there is a universal definition, and I think that's more like my personal definition, and I want to explain to you all. So for me, the architecture is the combination of decisions and trade-off, and the tensions between decision and trade-off will result into a design. So this design is basically something made by design, so someone intentionally made it, or it could be totally by accident, right? So most folks say, oh, I don't have architecture. That's not true. You might not have a good architecture, right? Because you maybe not think through your decisions, and not evaluate your trade-offs well, but you have an architecture, even if it's a poor one or by accident. So what I mean by decisions, right? I think that's an important thing. So there are several forms of decision, right? So a decision could be like a law, something like the governance says that something needs to happen some way. It could be a compliance that some organization said it needs to happen. Some regulatory organization said something needs to happen in a specific way. It could be something your customers are asking. It could be like someone in your company believe it needs to happen. So some people call decisions requirements. Lean thinking prefers to call it decisions, and I also prefer to call it decisions because, you know, it needs to be clear that maybe these decisions can change, right? And they're not written on the stone, they're not holy, they're just decisions, they're just our current status quo. And I believe that's why for me it's important to call it, rather than needs or requirements, call it decisions, right? So these are decisions we are taking. Trade-offs, they will happen based on some choices for some specific technology or some specific flow or some specific balance between different concerns. So it might be balancing, you know, complexity and performance or complexity and security. And basically the trade-offs means, you know, if I get one thing, I'm probably gonna lose another. And you carefully need to balance multiple trade-offs and see, you know, where is the suited spot that you want to land. And basically then, that's why for me, you know, the architecture is basically the tension between the decisions and the trade-offs. And this results into a design, which is well-intended or by accident, but you're gonna get a design in the end of the day. For me, architecture is about big rocks. There's lots of folks who believe that a software architect needs to deal and fix all problems on the universe. And I don't think that's the case, right? First, because, you know, in your business, you just have so few, opportunities to do things. So you really need to, you know, choose your energy where you want to put your energy. So that's one thing. And secondly, you need to understand that you still have engineers, you have developers, you have a team, you have multiple teams that can think they are smart. There's people who believe, there's management who believe like teams are not smart and architects should tackle all the complexity. I think this is a bottleneck. This doesn't work. It is not sustainable at all. So for me, teams are smart and they can take care of several big problems, all right? In architecture, I would say it's focused on the big rocks, not focusing on all small rocks. I think that's a very important thing. Another important thing about architecture is the fact that architecture is also about people. It has a sociological dimension about it. And, you know, with architecture, you want to do two kinds of scalability. You want to be able to scale systems for sure. So you want to add more users to the system, but also you want to be able to scale teams. And, you know, the main issue you see with these scale agile frameworks like SAFe, like LAS, like that, they really focus on management and, you know, ceremonies and process. They don't acknowledge architecture, right? And if you look successful Silicon Valley companies, they really scale based on architecture. That's how Amazon did, that's how Netflix did it. And basically, we need to understand that there's a huge relationship between things layout, you know, structure, and architecture. These things are really glued together. That's a very important thing. So, what are the properties of a well-architected system, right? There are many other properties, but if you have a well-architected system, right, you should have these desired properties. There are many more, but a couple of properties, right? So security, you want to have a system that's secure. You want to have abstractions. You want to have observability. You want to have performance. You want to have testability. You want to have reliability. You want to have operationability, isolation, scalability, and changeability. For me, the pure gold goes around changeability. I'm not saying the other properties are not important. Don't get me wrong. You want to have these properties, but the biggest thing is about change, right? Because if software is too expensive to change, you know, and it's too hard to change, probably there's an architecture problem right there, right? So, you know, decisions can be expensive because the cost of change these decisions, right? And that's why, you know, architecture is really critical in that sense. So even though some people may think, and I understand why, architecture could be something tangible, right? And architecture, in the end of the day, are a bunch of decisions that manifest as design or choices, right? But even these things can be intangible, right? The problems of a poor or poorly architected system are very real and very easy to spot. So you might have cost issues, right? And cost issues could be your solution is too expensive to maintain, it's not cost effective, like you need to pay a lot for vendors or for cloud providers, or the cost to maintain the solution because of the complexity is so high, and architecture might play a huge role on it. Another problem you might see is slowness, right? You see a system that is slow, that's not performing well, or you might have downtimes, or you might have a very bad and slow time to market where your competitors might be really going faster than you, or you could see a lot of bugs, errors, and limitations. All these problems, they lead to poor user experience. And in the end of the day, either your users gonna be switching to another provider or to another solution, and you know this will mean that you're gonna lose revenue. So in the end of the day, architecture problems could really kill your business, right? If not, you're gonna have revenue lost. So it's really important to have a well-architected system. Lots of folks today, right, could imagine that architecture today is about cloud. And basically, the only architecture that exists is cloud. Because easily, you could look to these problems and say, well, Diego, if there's a cost, because probably, you know, in your AWS or in your Google Cloud, you are spending too many things. If there's a slowness, probably you're using the wrong instance profile, instance size. If there's downtime, you know, probably you are lacking some of your SRE DevOps work. If there's low time to market, probably something on the team, like it's not being agile enough and stuff like that. Or if there's bugs, errors, and limitations, probably that's a test or analysis problems. It could be the case, but it also could be because of the architecture. So the architecture could be the source of all of these things. And the architecture is not limited to the cloud. Don't get me wrong. Cloud is one part of the architecture. But architecture is bigger because you can manifest the architecture in several other elements, like the concepts that you have in your system, the flows that you have, the business flows, the technical flows, the structure that you express your code, the layers that you might have in different solutions, the coordination between what's local, what's global, the standards you might follow, the SCM model that you might be using, and also, you know, architecture manifests in a curated list of choices, like which language should be used for this problem or for this team? Which framework, which library, which data store, which computing modding? Are we doing EC2, ECS, EKS, serverless? Are we running this on the edge? Is IoT? which storage are we using, which caching, which messaging, which infrastructure. So architecture will manifest in all of these decisions. Now let's talk about the skills of a software architect. For me, there are three really big and important skills. The first skill is about leadership, and it's important to notice that leadership ends with the word ship, which means you need to ship, you need to deliver code, right? So architecture is like a building, right? If you don't deliver the building, it doesn't exist. Either it's done or it's not done. So you know, to have architecture, you need to have a system. You cannot have an architecture and not have systems, right? So these things are really coupled together. And basically, architecture means, you know, you need to help your team to ship the architecture, to ship the decisions, right? Otherwise, it doesn't exist. So there is an important factor of guidance here. Second, to be an architect, you really need to know how to do sales. This means you need to have clear and good communication skills. You need to know how to navigate to problems. You need to be able to convince the board or execs, explaining why some money needs to be invested this quarter or in that quarter for this or for that. And you also need to be leading the technical teams in order to achieve this specific vision or this specific set of decisions that are being taken and resulting in design. And also, this is the hardest part ever, is, you know, to be an architect, you kind of need to be like a good guesser. You need to guess things. And this is hard because, don't get me wrong, you could guess all the wrong things. You could get things you don't need, things that you are overcomplicating, all right? And it's easy to say, oh, we don't need it now. In the future, we figure, and actually the cost of change is so high, you cannot change your code that, you know, not deciding to do something right now is a decision and is a design, and that killed you, basically. So really, you need to be able to see things in the future, right? You need to be able to have like a crystal ball and think about, oh, do we might need a different data store for this problem? If the business is asking me this, probably they will be asking me that as well. So even if they're not specifically asking it for, you know, I think they will ask it again. So, you know, that kind of things are really, really key to have a good software architect in place. And this is the hardest part. This is really hard. Don't get me wrong. You know, have the ability to sell ideas, you know, leader, be a leader and lead the team is hard as well. But this one is specifically hard. You need to have a very good, you know, vision, and it only get this skill as the time pass, right? But it's something really important. So that's it, guys. I hope you like it. See you next time. Cheers.